Hello and welcome to our CUNY TV Town Hall, Rikers Island. Where do we go from here? I'm Carol Anne Riddell. Rikers Island has a long and controversial history. It is one of the world's largest jails, housing thousands of prisoners on a remote island in the East River. In 2017, the city's Lippman Commission recommended Rikers Island be permanently shut down. Mayor Bill de Blasio supported that position, and the closing is slated for 2027. But many argue, in the meantime, the chaos and dysfunction at Rikers have only gotten worse, with reports of abuse, lax security, and leadership failure. Earlier this fall, the mayor announced an emergency relief plan for Rikers, including efforts to address staffing, repairs, and crowding, adding, "We will uphold our obligation to provide a safe, clean environment on Rikers Island while pivoting to a fairer and more humane justice system." But the road to reform is complicated, and today we will tackle some of the tough questions. What is happening inside Rikers now? Is closing Rikers the best solution? And how will the community jails planned as replacements be different? Joining me to discuss all this and more are three people who have firsthand experience with Rikers. Andre Ward was formerly detained at Rikers Island and is now an associate vice president at the Fortune Society, an organization devoted to criminal justice issues. Marc Bullaro, he was formerly an assistant deputy warden at Rikers and is now an adjunct professor at John Jay College of Criminal Justice. And Coss Marte, also formerly detained at Rikers, is the CEO of ConBody, a fitness program he developed while in solitary confinement. He's also an advocate for the formerly incarcerated. Welcome to all of you, and thanks so much for being here.
Thank you for having me.
I think that since you all have firsthand experience with Rikers, it makes sense to start there. So perhaps each of you could just give us a brief description of your time there. Andre, why don't we start with you?
Yeah, in 1992, at the age of 18 years old, I was detained on Rikers Island. At the time, the population on Rikers had been about maybe 20,000 people or so, so it was unspeakably overcrowded. And as a result, you know, as a younger person going into that experience, I saw unspeakable things happen to people. I saw people being abused and traumatized, especially as adolescents at the time. And my experience is seeing people being slashed, seeing people being deprived of supports that they needed, really traumatized me.
Well, gosh, you were so young too. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Marc, you worked there for many years. What was your experience like?
Yes, well, I started the job in 1987, and I served almost 29 years. And I retired as an assistant deputy warden, and I was in that rank for the last 16 years of my career. Mm-hmm. And I worked in several commands throughout the city. And I've seen the department go from, in 1987, it was overcrowded. We had 22,000 inmates at the time.
Wow.
However, in the mid-90s and in 2000, we had relative control of the jails. And it's gone to today where we have lost control completely.
And Coss, how would you describe your experience at Rikers?
I was there, obviously I'm a little bit younger than Andre, but I was there 2004, I was there multiple times as a adolescent, an adult, and definitely traumatizing. You know, no matter what the experience, you know, a year was, you're ready to, you're transforming the way you're thinking, you're overprotecting yourself, mm-hmm. you don't know, you're in an open dorm room with 60 beds sometimes, and we can't sleep well. My first day there, I remember a vivid picture, and it's horrifying. Just mice. I'm talking about hundreds and hundreds of mice just running
everywhere.
And running into your buckets where you have your food at. Just a very disgusting, nasty place.
There's been actually a lot of reporting recently, as particularly in the New York Times, about conditions at Rikers. And I'd like to move now to what is happening there right now. I think we have to understand, though, as we talk about that there's sort of two aspects to this, one being the current crisis that's been greatly exacerbated by the pandemic, and then also these longstanding issues that have existed well before the pandemic with Rikers. So, you know, let me turn again to you, Andre. What is your understanding of what the situation is like for incarcerated people right now on Rikers?
Yeah, the people that are detained on Rikers Island now are experiencing tremendous neglect. there have been 14 people that have died now as a result of being under New York City DOCSIS custody. And that's a result of the neglect and the abuse. Certainly COVID-19 has exacerbated those conditions. And then on the other side, on the correctional staff personnel side, there's not been the kind of presence that's needed to support like people having that COVID experience. And so officers AWOLing, not showing up to work, contributes to the conditions that we see now.
Yes, and of course, like, staffing has been widely documented as a problem. Of course, you know, a pandemic is a situation where none of us expected or had experience with. But Marc, what is your sense of what's happening with the staffing at this moment? And what is it like for staffers to work there?
Well, right now, Rikers Island and other New York City jails like VCBC in the Bronx, it's a dystopian environment. And there is a lawlessness and anarchy, and the staff is not able to provide the need to the inmates. And when I say provide the need, I mean staff is not able to protect the people incarcerated. Staff is not able to let everybody use the phone. When the food is brought to the housing areas, the distribution of the food does not go to every person that's there.
And why is that exactly?
Well, we've lost control of the jails. We've lost control, we have lost our authority, and because of that, we're unable to protect the inmates and provide the needs to the people in the jails. And as a result of that, because of the lawlessness and the void in the power, the gangs have filled that void, and they fill that eagerly. And now the gangs are providing protection to the people in jail. The gangs are controlling the phone. The gangs are controlling the distribution of the food. When the food is brought to the housing areas, the gang leaders and gang members will distribute that food. And of course, it's not distributed evenly. And because of that, more people are encouraged to join the gang just to survive.
Yeah. Coss, what's your reaction to that? Does that sound like what you hear is happening for people who are detained at this moment?
I hear it, but then I also have seen it before. You know, it's not something new that...
Not entirely.
You know, I think what we the pictures that we see in of the holding cells and people alternating the floor to go to sleep and getting a space to, you know, sit on a bench, that's been happening for years. You know, these holding cells that have been overcrowded for years.
Yeah.
Now that we have cell phones, we have cameras, we have more things of that nature, like, now is it bringing it up to light. I actually posted on my Instagram and everybody, like, interacted, you know, that was formerly incarcerated on that post, and they were like, hey, that's how I was in the 90s, how it was in the early 2000s. Now that we have social media, now we can see it.
Like many things in life, we are more aware of in ways because we can see it for ourselves.
But personally, I can't talk about how horrible it is right now, because I haven't been inside since I was going in there volunteering and bringing our program inside since 2018.
Yeah. You know, I think we can't talk about Rikers and we can't talk about criminal justice generally without talking about the disproportionate impact on communities of color. Does one of you want to jump in on that?
Yeah, I think it's important to have that historical context that Black and Latinx and people who are poor in communities in New York City have had the highest experience of being detained on Rikers and by extension incarcerated in New York State prisons. Over 75% of the people coming from New York City are comprising 85% of the people in New York State prisons. That speaks to some other systemic issues and failures and why people are going to jail and prison to begin with. And so this disproportionality of Black and brown representation in jails and prisons speaks to larger systemic issues that's driven oftentimes around race and racism. And that has to change.
I remember as a kid walking down the street, and it felt normal to see a squad car, or we used to call it TNT, you know, on Tuesday and Thursday, that they were gonna jump out of the cars and just put us on the wall. And it was, we're just going to the bodega, you know?
Yeah,
there was days I was not doing the right thing, but there was days I was just walking down the block and I was getting stopped and frisked. So that became a norm. But, you know, I also went to school in the Upper East Side for 1 year. I didn't see any cop cars over there, you know?
Yeah.
I didn't see any of the kids that were going to school with me at that time, you know, get stopped in the street, and they didn't have that experience. So,
yeah. I think one thing that people don't always realize about Rikers is that many people there are awaiting trial. They have not, in fact, been convicted of anything. How do we get to that situation? Marc, can you maybe speak to that?
Sure. Well, most of the people that are awaiting trial could not make bail or were not offered bail. And that's why they remain in custody. But now with the new bail law, as you see, the population is going down.
Yes.
Because many crimes that people that are alleged have committed now do not require bail. So
right.
People are released. But that's basically the reason is that most people who have the ability to get out of jail and fight their case from their home have the finances to post bail in the past.
Yeah. And what do you have a reaction to that situation?
Yeah, I'd like to respond to that. You know, the mayor had set out to reduce over 5 years the New York City jail population from 7,000 to maybe 4. And we had actually gotten to that point during COVID-19, especially to maybe 35 or so above. However, there has been an uptick in
yes.
the population on Rikers Island as a direct result of judges posting bail, not posting, but obviously using bail in a way that increases the jail population. And that's hugely concerning. The rollback of bail reform in and of itself is hugely concerning. And that's why we see an uptick on the amount of people from like 3,500 or so, it's going up to maybe 4,000 or so now, especially during the pandemic.
Well, I think that one thing that we have to talk about in that sense is that it's not, closing a jail is not in and of itself changing systemically the issues that we mm-hmm. face as a society. We're really talking about education, we're talking about mental health, we're talking about drug prevention, we're talking about a whole host of other things as well that have to happen, I think. Would you agree with that?
To a certain extent. I mean, like, drug prevention is, you know, equally, you know, Hispanic, Black, or and white people are
yes.
using drugs at the same rate. So,
yeah,
definitely
yes.
we have to prevent the drugs. We've got to try to bring rehabilitation centers and things of that nature. But what I'm saying is, you know, when we look at Rikers Island, 95% of the people that are there are Black and brown people.
Yes, yes.
And so, you know, we talk about drug prevention, you know, what's really happening. I think we need a different alternative to incarceration. And sorry to...
I think my point is that there's a cycle, though. There
yes.
is a cycle of poverty. That there's
yes.
a cycle of situations and circumstances that drive this.
Yeah, there are generating factors that leads to behavior. If you're in an environment where there's deprivation, lack of resources, lack of supports, people are often inclined to behave in a way to survive. And so when trauma and pain is created as a result of deprivation, people respond in really unnatural ways.
Mm-hmm.
So that may be harming someone else, taking your purse, taking your car, right, which is a function and symptom of other traumas that someone has experienced. And we criminalize that. And we look at the outcome rather than the cause.
May I ask a question?
Yes, absolutely.
If I understood you correctly, we shouldn't criminalize somebody stealing somebody's purse?
No, that's not what I was
okay.
saying.
That's the way I understood it.
I apologize for
yeah.
that. What I'm saying is that the systems that people live under, particularly Black and brown communities, that's connected to drivers of racism in particular, creates environments where people often harm themselves and each other. What that looks like is someone robbing someone, someone harming someone, stabbing or shooting someone or selling drugs as a means to survive under those kind of oppressive conditions. And so therefore, I am not trivializing the fact that people causing harm should not be held accountable. But the way in which we as a society, which is unnatural and by extension of the country, punish people, it's retributive. And not restorative, in where the people can heal, not only the person that was harmed, but the person who has also been harmed that's responsible for causing harm by the very systems that I'm talking about.
Go ahead, Marc.
I could agree for the most part with what he's saying, and ultimately, I would like to see those that unfortunately do wind up in jail or prison. Jails and prisons ultimately should be transformed into universities, transformed into trade schools where you can get a certificate. Transformed into inner development academies for that, if that's possible. And, you know, for those, of course, the people that are in there that desire that.
Yes, yes. Well, let's move now then to what should happen next? As we've said, the plan right now is to close Rikers by 2027 to replace it with smaller borough-based jails. And before we get into the details on that, I just want to ask each of you to quickly give me, you know, a sentence on your response to should Rikers be closed? Is that the right way forward? And Coss, why don't we start with you?
I think it should definitely be closed. And these borough jails, I don't think they should be open. If we're spending $9 billion, $10 billion, I just read, to open up these four new facilities, why can't we alternately use those funds to open up rehabilitation centers, mental health centers?
Marc?
No, Rikers should not be closed, mainly because location is not going to fix this problem. Whether a jail is on Rikers or in a borough, it's not going to fix this problem by itself. It needs change of leadership and change of policies to fix this problem. And also, like Coss said, the $10 billion that are going to be spent could be used for education, proactive community programs, and also education in jail or in prison.
Andre?
Yeah, I think that Rikers should certainly be closed. I subscribe to the creation of the borough-based jails as a means to an end, not an end in and of itself, in that the borough-based jails would be able to support keeping people closer to their communities, to the resources that they need, and invariably create a situation where people can be able to live a life of contribution once they're released from mm-hmm. those kind of experiences. So again, I'm not saying that's an end in and of itself, the borough-based jails, but it's a means to an end, but Rikers should close.
Coss, are you saying no jails?
No jails.
No jails at all. So we go from...
We're talking about opening up the largest, tallest jail in the whole country, 50-story building in downtown Manhattan, which is going to hold, I think I read, 3,000 to 4,000 inmates. And we're holding only 4,000 inmates in Rikers Island. All we have to do is... people don't know this, but we already have existing jails in these boroughs. Why can't
yes,
we just
that's true.
Renovate these existing facilities and reduce the population where we could hold already?
So you're not, so just to clarify, you're not saying that jails should not exist in any form?
No, I definitely, people should be held accountable for their actions, and I think they should exist. But what I'm saying is we could close down Rikers Island, reduce the 1,000, I think it's only 1,000 inmates that we have to reduce, and we could hold all these other inmates in these actual borough jails that are already existing. They're in a bad shape, but I feel like with some of that funds, it could be renovated, fixed up, and open up different facilities.
There is a lot of talk about reducing the jail population at this moment, and the city has said that's a goal, and that is underway, as you've indicated. My question is, how do we do that? And at the same time, everyone wants a safe city. Everyone wants a city where crime rates are as low as they can possibly be. How do we do both of those things, reduce the jail population, keep our city safe at the same time?
I think it starts with pouring resources in the communities that are most lacking. I also think when we talk about the construction of borough-based jails, one of the things is it's about creating safer, smaller, and fairer
yes.
kind of environments. And I don't know if renovating older facilities would get at that.
What Coss said about the jails already existing, they are smaller than the new jails that are going to be built in the boroughs. So if you are for smaller jails, maybe Coss's idea is the best one, to renovate the jails that are currently in the boroughs instead of spending $10 billion to build new jails.
Do you think that Rikers could be sufficiently renovated and cleaned
yes.
up so that
yes.
it could be an effective place?
Yes, absolutely renovate them and renovate the borough jails go with that, because the borough jails are small now. The location is not going to determine safety. In order for the jails to be safe, the uniformed staff have to regain control to protect the inmates, because right now we
point.
Cannot provide the need. We cannot protect inmates. We cannot make sure inmates use the phone, like I said. The food distribution is being done by gang leaders in the jails. So we cannot protect the inmates. So a location is not going to change that.
But in terms of location, I do want to talk about that for a minute, because there has been a lot of talk about how isolated Rikers is. Not only is it sort of an out of sight, out of mind situation, but also it's difficult to get there for loved ones who want to visit. It can be difficult, I have read and heard, for client attorney visits.
Mm-hmm.
So If we were to go to a borough-based system, wouldn't that alleviate a lot of that problem?
Yeah, I think it would. And I want to speak to the notion of, and I've heard the gentleman raised on several occasions, this idea of loss of control. And I don't know if people who should be viewed as people need to be controlled necessarily. I think it's about engaging people with interventions that reflects who they are as human beings and helping them to develop as such. I know from personal experience, and there are accounts now, where the correctional staff themselves perpetuate the very thing that he's talking about, right? Make people that are detained running the food and distributing it to this, that person, making sure and supporting gang involvement in different ways, even encouraging it as a means to say, see, folk are dangerous.
Again, we do live in a large city that we want to be safe, and there is a lot of concern about crime as well. Marc, did you want to say something
may I
on
respond
that?
To
yes,
that?
You may, of course.
First of all, those are very serious allegations against uniform staff that he's making. Very serious allegations. Secondly, all you have to do is look at the statistics. When I talk about control, I'm talking about control of behavior, just like any police department throughout the country does, or any correction department. This year alone, there have been more than 300 inmate slashings. In 2008, there were 19 for the entire year. In 2009, there were 21. This year alone, maybe 350. Mm-hmm. Inmate slashings, 100 stitches to the face, 150 stitches to the face. If you're not concerned about that, there's an issue.
Well, you know, what I appreciate is that we can have a spirited conversation.
Sure. Don't take umbrage to what he's saying.
We can all agree to disagree on some points.
I will say that and this is not an attack on anyone, I think this is factual. Over 1,500 correctional staff have went AWOL as a result of COVID or whatever reasons. And at the same time, you said this year there's been an uptick in slashings. And so when you have a lack of personnel in place, right, because of AWOLing, et cetera, right, intentional that is, then there's a likelihood that these kind of conditions that he described will increase.
This is not obviously an issue that we are going to resolve right now on this show. But in terms of looking at the other side, we talked about Rikers as an isolated location and why borough-based jails would help improve some of the problems that come with that. However, we have to also talk about those neighborhoods. Mm-hmm. What do you think is going to happen? Do you expect that we will see increased opposition in the neighborhoods where those new jails are supposed to be sited? Coss, what's your reaction? You're shaking your head.
No, because they're building them in the exact area where they're already existing jails. And so people are just going in there for visiting. I do agree it'll be alleviating for families to go back inside. Mm-hmm. I mean, I have family and friends that I visited multiple times, and it takes all day. You know, you have to go from, I live in the Lower East Side, you take the F train to, you know, 21st.
It's complicated, right?
You take the Q100, then you take another bus internally to get to your spot. Having the fact that we have already existing jails in our areas that are, they're planning to build it in the same area is not going to bring an uptick in crime. But I don't believe they should be built.
But do people recognize that? Do people who live in those neighborhoods
don't even realize there's already jails in these areas?
Okay, fair point.
I think there will be increased resistance by the community because the community was used to small jails in the boroughs. Now you're going to have high-rise jails, like Coss said, with many more people incarcerated in them. Secondly, it's going to increase the problem of parking in the community. There's problems.
It always comes back to parking in New York, right?
There's problems in New York already. Now add to that thousands of correction officers being assigned to a borough jail with parking.
First of all, looking at Rikers Island historically, it was something that was founded not on the basis of honoring and the humanity of people, right? When you look at its history and who founded it, et cetera. And then there's the environmental piece when it comes to Rikers Island and the toxics that are there, right? And so the landfills, those things, right? It's not an environment where you want to keep people housed.
I just want to give each of you a chance to give us a final thought on the topic as we get ready to wrap things up. Coss?
As you know, like my brother won the city council District 1 position, and I'm standing by his side by not building more jails, not closing Rikers Island, and I think on an environmental issue in Rikers Island is a huge issue there, but also building more construction is another environmental issue that we have to talk about as well.
I think the politicians have, for the last 5 or 6 years, have been waiting for 2027 to fix this problem. Mm-hmm. This problem needs to be fixed now, and it should have been fixed 5, 6 years ago, not waiting to close Rikers and fix the problem, but they think by going to a different location.
Andre, final thought?
We have to decarcerate people. We have to make sure that people are in spaces that reflects and supports their humanity and not dehumanizes them. And I think that people on the right side of history today understand that we have to change these conditions and look at the deeper systemic issues that drive why black and brown people are ending up in jails and prisons to begin with.
Well, thank you. And we do need to end things there, but certainly there will be more to come on this topic as our city continues to work on criminal justice reform and a new mayor takes over. For now, I just want to thank our guests for being part of this important conversation. We so appreciate your being here and sharing your expertise.
Sure.
And thanks to all of you for watching. I'm Carol Anne Riddell for CUNY TV.